Hello everyone, Narcissus Free almost here, and I was thinking the other day about making it easier to explain a narcissist and where they stand developmentally, which then got me thinking about transactional analysis, one of my favorite areas of psychology. Plus, I was also just having a bit of fun tinkering with different theories. So feel free to extrapolate this to present day Western culture. For example, how the radical activists are trying to change culture as a cuisine. When you use the concept of ego states and then begin to observe which state people are in when relating to one another, you will be amazed how much sense it makes. And then you can use that information to devise an effective plan to deal with your situation. Just in case you don't know what TA is, here's a quick synopsis. And by the way, the information I'm presenting is totally oversimplified for the sake of time, so please look into it further for greater understanding. It's worth it, even if you're mildly curious about psychology. So meet Mr. Eric Byrne, MD, creator of Transactional Analysis and author of the best-selling book, Games People Play. And to set the stage with the very basics, I'll be quoting Dr. Byrne here.
The unit of social intercourse is called a transaction. If two or more people encounter each other, sooner or later one of them will speak, or give some other indication of acknowledging the presence of the others. This is called transactional stimulus. Another person will then say or do something which is in some way related to the stimulus, and that is called the transactional response.
Basically, when people communicate, it's called a transaction, and that makes perfect sense. Now, how do you use this so behavior can be identified, observed, and then analyzed? Glad you asked. According to Dr. Byrne, every person has three ego states, which he calls parent, adult, and child. Concerning the parent ego state, there are actually two subtypes. There is the nurturing parent, described as looking after, nurturing, and comforting people. It is rooted in understanding and tries to make people feel good about themselves. Actions taken from this state instills confidence and encourages others to go on and is full appreciation for people and their positive behaviors. The second is the dreaded critical parent, which is all about blaming others and giving unconstructive criticism. It includes behaviors like attacking other people, being extremely judgmental, not listening, and not even interested in explanations. The critical parent will write you off as a bad person rather than deal with your behavior. And I'm pretty sure this is where the narcissist lives most of the time. Next is the adult ego state, where behaviors are about collecting, analyzing, and evaluating information, making sense of that information, and making balanced judgments about things. The adult ego state deals with facts and not feelings and emotions. It responds to the feelings and emotions of its natural child ego states and considers the opinion and beliefs of the parent ego state. It is based on thinking before speaking. The adult ego state is about trying to understand why do we respond or behave in a particular way and make conscious choices. And then there is the child ego state, and this is the source of our emotional responses. In contrast to the parent, the child represents the recordings in the brain and nervous system of internal events associated with external events the child perceives. Stated another way, it is like a mental tape recorder, recording events on one track, which would be the parent, and the feelings associated with those events in another track, or the child. In other words, the child ego state is a recording of internal events or the responses of the little person to what he sees and hears. It is the recording of joy, surprise, amazement, and all the wonderful feelings associated with our first discoveries of life on one hand. On the other hand, terror, agony, and all the fearful feelings. Examples of recordings in the child would include When I saw the monster's face, I felt really scared. The clown at the birthday party was really fun. Now, putting this all together to describe the narcissist, which will also be in line with objects relations theories, think of the narcissist's egostasis caricatures in roles they play as seen or rather recorded in childhood. For example, the narcissists in their critical parent ego state are merely mimicking what they heard, such as, you're good for nothing, you can't do anything right, you're lazy, and on and on. For example, when my ex-narc did this, he looked like he was reading from a script and overacting with its drama included. He looked and sounded like a little lady, only 6'3" and 230 pounds. It was pretty frightening, not to mention weird. Then there is the narcissist's petulant, entitled, and retarded child ego state. Remember, the narcissist's development is arrested anywhere from infancy to very early childhood. So this rebellious child ego state will be demanding, controlling, as well as oppositional. I believe this attitude evolves as the narcissist grows into adulthood, and using their size and learned adult behaviors, they leverage this position of perceived power to effectively bully their targets. Lastly is the adult ego state, and you can probably guess what this is for the narcissist. If you guess the false self, you'd be correct, because the narcissist will not have any proper adult state, only the fantasy they've created for themselves. So what does this look like when you plug in some object relations theory? For the fully integrated person, otherwise known as healthy, the adult ego state will be in charge most of the time, meaning as they've developed in a healthy way with empathy intact, their mental representations of self and object, remember, object is the internalized primary caregiver, have fully integrated, thus extinguishing the primitive splitting defense. They may have a critical parent internalized if they had an abusive parent, but because they are conscientious and possess self-awareness, they will have eradicated this part of themselves, having empathy for others and not wanting to treat them in any sort of abusive manner, mainly because you know what it feels like. Remember, empathy is the fail-safe mechanism and interrupts the potential for abusive or dangerous behavior toward others. For the pathological narcissist, integration doesn't take place at all because of their rest in development. Therefore, the parent ego state will consist mostly of the parent object, or rather critical parent object, if not exactly a mirror image, as the self will have been shriveled to near non-existence. Remember, by preferring and overusing their manic defenses in infancy and early childhood, the narcissist has killed off their real self in favor of a false self, a self that they can be in control of, or so they believe, and a self they can use to manipulate the external world in order to meet their needs and fantastical desires. You can see how important integration of the mental representations in childhood are to become the mature adult person able to function in relationships in a healthy way. That is, where there's an absence of abuse, manipulation, and deception. Finally, using transactional analysis with a touch of object relations theory might give you the visual representation of the pathological narcissist's internal world and how they will relate to you. When you realize you are dealing with someone who is developmentally stunted, has failed to develop empathy, and living in a fantasy land where you are just a prop for them to use as they please, you will start to embrace just how dangerous they are. With no empathy or shame, a person can do anything to anyone to get what they want, and in many cases, they just abuse people for the sadistic pleasure of it out of sheer boredom. It's just downright creepy and evil. Once you get enough distance from them, as well as information about this disorder, and start to see them for what they really are. And that is, you are dealing with a highly disturbed person whose only goal is to fool you for long enough to take anything of value you might possess. And that includes your best and sweetest character traits so they can use them on their next target. In the end, they will destroy you consciously to cover up their crimes. So, if you made it this far, big congratulations. I will award you a virtual medal. I got started on this and just got halfway through, a little carried away with the theories and such. I thought, oh, what the hell, I'll just finish it. Probably won't get too many views, but maybe y'all learn something. The ones who made it through, that is.